Please welcome back our experienced moderator, Chief Business Correspondent at the Danish Broadcast Corporation, Nina Munk Pine.
Yes, thank you very much, and as always, fantastic to be here and part of this fantastic day at Aarhus University. So this last session of today will be a bit differently than we're normally used to, because the presentation will be shorter and there will be a lot longer Q&A session. And there will also be prizes that the next speaker has brought himself to give out to the best questions. So please get on with it, and a lot more in the other sessions, because the vast majority of time will be based on the Q&A here. So, the next speaker's father is named Thor, and his own middle name is Nicholas, and those two merged together into the name Thornico. They brought the collapsed, almost anyway, sports brand Hummel in the mid-90s, and the rest is history, even though a long one. Please welcome the next speaker, Christian Stadil, who is here, will talk about creativity as part of how becoming successful instead of facts and figures. Christian Stadil.
Thank you very much for that very nice introduction. First off, I'd like to say that I've really been looking forward to this day. And I really haven't been disappointed. I really think the rollout, the execution, the whole platform that you have created here, the impressive lineup of speakers and so on, I'm really in awe. It's really fantastic that you have done this and you have succeeded in doing this in this scale and at this level. So really, really great. Another reason for me being happy in terms of being here today as a speaker is also that we are in Aarhus. Aarhus, where I have been doing business for more than 15 years. As mentioned, we have Hummel here in the city down at the harbor side. You probably know where it is, most of you. And also still we have numerous real estate investments here in this city. I don't know, is anybody of you living in one of my apartments in Guldsmedegade? Number 17 and 19? Okay, no, okay, but anyway, if you're interested at some point, then please let me know. So also for this reason, very nice to be here. And then, as you mentioned, I come bearing gifts. You say to promote and to motivate you to pose a lot of questions. We really want to tear down the fourth wall. So please ask all the questions that you like. But again, as a kind of as a grease, as a motivation, a further motivation, we brought some gifts, or I have, and the gifts are as follows. And this has nothing to do with the plugging our brand, for sure not. First off, I brought the fantastic, I need to say iconic, football jersey from the rock and roll football club St. Pauli in Hamburg. Pretty cool, isn't it? When St. Pauli, they are playing, when they come into the field, AC/DC are playing, one of their main sponsors is Jack Daniels. And when you sit in the VIP session, a section of the stadium, Million Tour, they serve unlimited ad libitum Jack Daniels. So pretty cool club. Also, I brought this jersey, and you'll in a moment find out why. This is the national team jersey of the Afghanistan national football team. And last, for sure not least, I've also brought this bad boy, namely I'll nearly call it the national team jersey of Christiania. So this you can also win. And please notice, you probably know the club Liverpool. In Liverpool, their payoff, that is, you'll never walk alone. Their payoff is, you'll never smoke alone. And I also brought two books that I wrote together with Professor Lene Tanggaard last year in the shower with Picasso about innovation and creativity. But on the jersey of Afghanistan, I'd like to start with a little video.
They were warning us to stop playing football, otherwise it will be not good for us, otherwise they will beat us, they were throwing stones on us while we were playing football. And in Afghanistan, when a girl plays any kind of sport, They will call it by the name of bad girl. And sometimes they were calling us bitch or prostitute when we were going out of the school, because they were saying it's not a good sign if a girl plays sport. Football was something for us to show that women and men has the same right. If a man can play football, why not women? And that was the starting point that we should stand for our right. It was very difficult in Afghanistan to have the same right like a man have in the country. As the team and the women football was growing and growing and they're becoming more stronger, and I become the leader of women's football in Afghanistan, and my voice was getting stronger and stronger. I had a huge support from media, and I was campaigning for women's rights and women activities through football or through sport. So at the meantime, I had I was facing many challenges and many problems. A group of people that they were against women activities, and they didn't like that I was standing in front of media, in front of camera, and they called me and they blamed that I'm against the religion and I'm encouraging the women to go against religion and against the culture of the country. And they started the problem, and it was going out and out to the people that I'm the one who wants to encourage the women and make a strong group to stand for against the religion and the culture of the country. My family was facing problems. Even my brothers, they had to fight outside, and they beat my brother, and they stand in front of my parents. They were standing. They were trying to force them to stop me for being in front of the camera, being active. I didn't have support from my government. I didn't have support from powerful guys in my country, so I had to escape to survive and to stand and work more for women. And it was Homo company who helped me to escape. And it's not easy that in one night you have to decide to leave your family and the love, which is for sport and for the girls, for my teammates. That's what I will miss forever.
In 2010, we had a board meeting in Hummel, when we were at the time situated in Viby, not so far from here. And along the way, it was kind of a normal board meeting. You know, we looked at our realized numbers, we looked at our projections for the year, we looked at the different markets, we looked at our investments, and so on. But suddenly, during this board meeting, a little bit en passant, our CFO at the time, Jens Bienig, he said, "By the way, some guy from A Afghanistan Football Association called our agent Sasha in southern Germany." I had to make him repeat it because I was not really sure of what he really said or tried to communicate. But when I understood, I right away stopped the meeting. I went outside and I got a hold of our CMO at the time, Henning, our chief marketing officer. And we started Googling right then and there. We used search words as Afghanistan football, Afghanistan women's football. And we didn't have to search for a very long time before horrific images like the ones you see up here arose. All often accompanied by writing, by wording, saying that during the Taliban from 1996 to 2001, women were killed only because of having done one thing, namely living out their passion for sports, including for football. But the case was, what we could read also, was that that was also the case today and then in 2010. And we didn't have to use a lot of time, and I'll try not to be too pathos-filled, but what we actually said to each other literally was, we have to do this. If not us, then who? So we wrote a contract with the Afghanistan Football Association, and the first milestone took place on the 29th of October 2010 when we arranged, facilitated and financed a football match in Kabul, in Afghanistan, between the female Afghanistan national team playing against a multinational team of ISAF and NATO soldiers representing countries as the US, Germany and Italy. And this was really an amazing day and still one of the biggest highlights in my professional career. To stand there in the middle of what at the time was a kind of a war zone and see these passionate girls for the first time walking into the pitch to play this freedom football match. And of course, unfortunately I have to say, of course, there had been threats on our life, on my life, on the company's life, you know, on the girls' lives, for which reason we had to roll out the match on an abandoned helicopter field, but in a NATO-controlled area. Our first vision was to have the match at the old Olympic Stadium in Kabul, but that was totally impossible. But a really fantastic, fantastic day. Have you seen the movie Apocalypse Now? Dommedag Nu by Francis Ford Coppola, one of my favorite movies. In that, there is a scene where the protagonist, Colonel Kilgore, played by Robert Duvall, he sends his troops out surfing in the middle of the war zone when the napalm is blowing up all around them. Maybe you remember this scene. And it was kind of how we felt, maybe a little over-exaggerated, but you know, it was really a special moment. And it had such a tremendous impact on us that when we came home, we demounted, we eradicated our current, at that time, vision, mission, and even strategy work that, by the way, were just collecting dust on the shelf. We had, as many others, a huge, you know, vision. You know, everybody wanted buy-in, for which reason they always become without the loose steering power and they become way too generic. That was also the case for ours. So what we did instead was that we made a strong promise, a vow, and one that should have steering power and one that should work both internally as externally in the company. The vision being, or the promise being, that we wanted to change the world through sport. Ambitious, yes. Are we ever going to achieve it? Probably not. But I believe that a strong vision, a strong company dream, or a promise, maybe just have to be within sight or within view, and maybe not within grasp. Another thing that happened to us was this. A lot of press from around the world, they had a big coverage from this event, the likes of CNN, BBC, and so on. According to Observer, we got the press value at around 22 million kroner. Those of you who works with PR have to tell you that the 22 million kroner in press value is not the same as seeing them on the bottom line. You probably know that also, Dildo. There's a little bit of a gap there. But that being said, it had an effect also because we saw that this way of working was a way that we could differentiate ourselves and position ourselves in an extremely competitive marketplace where we're up against these giants. You probably heard about them, Nike and Adidas, you heard? Or pretty big monsters. And these guys, they can do so much more than we can. There's so many things that they can do that we'll never be able to do. A big strategic product area for Hummel is footwear. And I have to ask you something. I don't know if it fits the format, but I'll ask you anyway. These bad boys here, can you, by raising your hand, tell me, who of you calls these bad boys sneakers? Please do that. Okay, good, good. How many calls them gummisko? Did you? And how many says gymnastik or kondisko? Okay, you say, okay, okay. Sorry, hopefully I don't offend you too much, but the saying goes that people under 40, they say sneakers or sneaks. people between 40 and 55, they say gummisko, and people north of 55, they say gymnastik kondisko. But that's sidestepping a little bit. When we talk about sneakers, you know, I really don't fit the demographic, but I call them that anyway. We have really wanted to get into this this product group since we took over the company, as you mentioned, in 99. We saw that especially Puma at the time, they had 65% of their EBT result coming from sneakers. And we wanted in on that that game. And we've been growing quite a lot on sneakers today. We sell more than 2 million pairs a year. But still in Hummel, we only have 7 people designing and product developing sneakers. And that has to be compared with Nike. Nike has 700 people designing and product developing sneakers. I could also make another example or analogy. Those of you who have watched Danish television through the years, you remember Husli Tandbørsten? Where Kasper, he says, do you want to go to Bailey or to Brønderslev? It's a little bit the same. Nike, they sponsor Barcelona, and we sponsor Brøndby. It's a little bit the same. So in this environment, and in this marketplace, in this space, we could choose to curl down in a fetus position and die. But we then decided, we had decided that before, but we really there found out that there actually was something that the big guys couldn't do. And that was the first time we acknowledged that, because they can beat us in so many ways. Adidas, they have football fields where there are sensors underneath, where they can measure the pressure of football boots. I don't know how much does a football field like that with sensors underneath cost. I don't know, 200, 300 million kroner. We cannot afford all that. So we found out through this event, through this way of working, especially combined with the Afghanistan Football Association, that here there was a way that we could position and differentiate ourselves in this in this market. So it really played an immense role for us also as a company. There was other, highlights in connection, and there has been, and there still is, connection with this collaboration. In 2013, the Afghanistan Football Association actually won the biggest football award in the world, namely the Ballon d'Or. And in the same year, they also won the Southeast Asian Games. So they also kind of play pretty good football. John Kerry, he visited Afghanistan a couple of years ago, and he played his football skills pretty much sucks. So I think because of that, this movie where he plays against the Afghan women, it went viral around the world, which of course we also liked. I made an interview with Al Jazeera in the slipstream of the event, and this was before Bin Laden, he was killed. And I don't know how you thought at the time, but I thought that Bin Laden, he was sitting in some cave in Torbore. Of course, we found out that he lived in a rather big mansion in Pakistan. But when I was speaking there, I was so self-conscious. And I'm self-conscious to start with, so I was even more self-conscious. And I repeated myself during this interview 8 times. And my very nice colleagues, they have counted. Because I said the same thing 8 times. Namely, this is not about politics. It's only about sports. This is not about religion, it's only about sports. Because I saw, for my inner eye, I saw Bin Laden sitting in this cave with his Kalashnikov and all that, and looking at this strange, bald guy with the glasses, you know, and doing like this. I tried to secure myself a little bit through that. In 2011, a collective of professors and authors, they wrote a book called Creative Leadership. A great book. I'm also actually a professor in creative leadership myself at CBS, but in this book, one of the authors, Mary Murdoch, she says it in a very good way when posing the question, what will be the biggest transformative element in the 21st century, to which she answers kind of her own question in the book, namely, now I'm paraphrasing, that the biggest and most important thing in terms of creating positive, transformative change in the 21st century will be the strong ideas and will be creative leadership. And I don't know if it has the same impact on you, but when I read this, I thought, okay, so this way of finding the strong ideas that also can make a difference, there's something there. And I think, without boasting too much, I think the example with Afghanistan, that's why I also mentioned it here, I think that's an example of, maybe to a lesser degree than compared to bigger projects, but still, what a great, or at least a good idea can do in terms of combining, in this case, for the company, doing well with doing good. And there's really interesting possibilities in that realm between doing good and doing well. Now, we started by saying, talking a little bit about Thornico. I'll do it rather briefly, just so you know, on the basis of what I speak here today, what is the frame. The company was founded a little more than 15 years ago from scratch. We are a conglomerate, which is very old school. For those of you who are studying organization, if you had asked McKinsey or Boston Consulting Group before the crisis whether the conglomerate way of driving a business is a good organizational model, I'm sure they would have said to you, no way, no way. Because a conglomerate is characterized with that we are in many different areas of business, in many different sectors, we have to do with many different brands and products. They would have told you that no, focus on one sector or very few sectors, go deep and focus on few products and business areas. But the crisis has actually looked upon us, we conglomerates, with rather nice and positive eyes, so to speak. Most conglomerates, and actually more than other organizational and corporate forums, have done proportionally better. And there's many, I have to say, right away, that have done way better than we have. But we have also done quite all right and have had a pretty good growth through the crisis. And why? Because we have a built-in Gungar Karuseller, you say, a kind of a way of leveraging our risk in the company, because namely we have to do with so many different business areas, meaning that on one hand we have to do with very cyclical businesses, as for instance the shipping business. An extremely volatile business, very dependent on macroeconomic tendencies. So shipping is moving, like the waves on which our vessels they sail. On the other hand, we also have to do with food. And you can say a little bit roughly or banal, in a banal way, that people always have to have something to eat. So that's a way of combining anti-cyclical and cyclical businesses. And that has actually, through the years, become a strategy for us. So we try to balance and leverage our engagement in the group between cyclical on one hand and anti-cyclical businesses on the other hand. On food, I have to tell you that for me, food is becoming more and more interesting. We're actually launching for the first time an end-consumer-directed brand, MIT, here next spring. But again, looking at overpopulation, this becomes more and more relevant. The latest number showing also from the think tank where Didle was a chairman and I a member, Big Future, that we're looking at maybe even more than 10 million people by 2050. And again, a little bit banal, put again, these people have to have something to eat. And that's why when you talk to venture companies today, some years ago, when you talk, they were looking at tech. But today, if you ask them, they will tell you that food and food-related companies are red hot. I had a meeting a couple of weeks ago with Jimmy Fusik, partner and CEO of Sunstone Capital, one of the leading venture companies in Denmark. I meet him twice a year. And I mentioned all the things that I've invested in the last years and so on. And the one he was most interested in was MIT. And I was like, what? Don't you want to hear about the tech stuff? And so, no, he was food. So I think that's becomes interesting to an increasing degree. We have 120 operational companies, meaning 120 companies within which there is activity. On the revenue side, We've had quite a good growth again. We started, as I mentioned, in the end of the 90s, but where we really started working and thinking as a company was actually around 2005. And from there on, we have had a pretty good revenue growth. Today, our revenue is a little bit more than 6 billion Danish kroner, and that is rather conservatively put without aggregating all our revenue from shipping, for instance, into our revenue. Our return on sales is still too little, vores overskudsgrad. For this year, we're going to land around 7% on the bottom line as compared to revenue. Still too little, but I think it's okay since we also have this growth and associated investments. So that's a needle point in terms of how we work. That was the company, that was the frame. So shouldn't we give Nina a big hand, applause, and then get some more questions for you? Shall I repeat the presents, or are you okay with them? Okay, please give her a hand.
No, give you a hand. Yeah, that's a fantastic question. Let's get on with the questions. And you know the system, but of course it's also possible to just raise your hand and we'll have people with hand mics coming down. So everybody just join in. And we'll see like how the question process goes before we decide whether to bring out the presents yes. during the session or afterwards. We'll figure that out. Alrighty, so Christian. So how come you didn't like the idea of a 38,000 DKK Baudi during the latest Lüftung? Okay, we'll go with the program on DR. Yep.
Did you all see that? There was a guy, a very sweet guy. He had this 38,000 kroner wooden bow tie. Why didn't I go with that? Maybe a little bit ironical, but still, you know, there has to be a certain correlation between product and product value, also in terms of how you price the product. And here, the gap between the value of the product, no matter how much marketing, branding, and storytelling you put on it, I think there was a too big gap between that and then the pricing. But he was a very nice guy, so more power to him. Actually, I can tell a funny side story. The other Løve from Løvens Hule, Dragon's Den, Birgit, she sent me a picture yesterday of a knitted bow tie that her granddaughter had made. And then she wrote to all of us, other lions, what do you think that should retail for? 12,000?
So, what else, Christian, what else did you gain from participating in that program? Was it kind of just waste of time in your kind of busy calendar, or would you do it again?
Super good question. And actually, this is I also always love actuality hooks, because today, before I reach my home in 1.5 hours, 2 hours, I have to decide, and this is real time, I have to decide whether to say yes to the second season of Løvens Hule.
Are we gonna get the answer now? We can tweet it, yeah! Woo!
All the other lions, they've all said yes. You know, they said yes, you know, they are really into this thing. And I got a mail from Jesper Buch when I was sitting in the room up here. Hey, shouldn't we all get a lion tattoo? And and I can tell you, now you probably know, I co-founded together with Daniel Arger and some great tech guys based on an idea by a fantastic guy called Johan, the company which is today by far the biggest tattoo community in the world, called Tattoo, more than 22 million unique visitors a month and so on. And through that, I already now have contacted one of the best tattoo artists in the world, so we're actually flying him down to Marbella, where Jesper Buch has his big house, where we have a lot of workshops in December. And then probably we're all going to get this lion tattoo. But yeah. Of course, I have to decide.
But that sounds like a yes, Christian. That sounds like you're not getting a lion tattoo.
Maybe in the end,
we can
hear
maybe
by hand raising, we can hear maybe, yeah.
Yeah, should he participate again?
Yeah.
Are we going for a
okay.
Is okay. That a yes? Can we say that's a yes?
Okay, in the end of the session, we make the
all right, we'll get back to that. We can give you one of your own
presents. But I like being answer. Part of it. I was very much in doubt in the beginning, and as now, I was also the last one by far. You know, they postponed the recording of the show 1.5 months and so on, because I very much in doubt. You know, it's always, you know, to balance, you know, what do you say yes to, what do you say no to, what about time, do we have time to work with this, and because it takes a lot of time to record. But I was very happy, you know, I think the other men and women has been it's really great to work with. We have really partnered up now. We have become friends. It's a cliche, but it's true. And then most importantly, you know, I think the quality Okay, there are some exceptions, but the quality of the entrepreneurs was quite high. And now we're in Aarhus, and as you might remember, I actually made the biggest investment in the whole series in an Aarhus-based company called Firtal Group, where we also own the biggest health platform in Denmark called Helsebixen. Fantastic guys, Jesper and Mikkel, living right here in Aarhus. So if you're looking for a job, check out Firtal Group, super guys. And just as an example, I invested at a valuation at 20 million kroner. Now we're doing a new round of investments now with a valuation that is four times as much as that. So also from a business perspective, it's been really good.
And so what have you learned? Have you learned anything yourself from participating in the Cave of the Lion, or what do we call it? In
yeah, yeah, I think so. You always get wiser when you talk to passionate entrepreneurs. Like today, I've been sitting with four students that had written really great essays, you know, getting really good and rowdy questions. And I think I can always, evolve and heighten my skill level for sure, for sure.
Fantastic. So we'll get back to it in the very end, right, Kristen?
Yes.
So let's move on to you've written a book. You are now a lecturer at CBS in creative leadership, and you're doing lectures in Copenhagen. And when is the student in Aarhus going to have the pleasure of that as well?
You're having it. Yeah, if the timing is right, I would love to combine maybe with a board meeting in Hummel and then come by at night, and maybe there's a torsdag spa or something the same day or something. I don't know. Do you have a torsdag spa? At CBS, they have a torsdag spa called Nexus. I don't know if you have. So that's a yes.
That's definitely an opportunity. Tell your the director of the place. Yeah. Alrighty. So let's get that one out of there. So. Are universities killing creativity?
Ooh, that's also a really good question. The short answer is no. I'm really, really impressed when I go to CBS. I've been also not to boast too much, but that's a privilege of standing here. You can do that. I've been a opening speaker at CBS for all the new generation at CBS before that, 4 years. And also through my professorship, I've been, of course, and I meet a lot of students, and I think the quality of questions, the quality of their case material when they make case competitions and so on CBS, and also just by from today when talking to these essayists, I'm so impressed by the your skill level, intelligence, maturity level. So that's one part of the answer. Has that to do with creativity? Not only. I think a challenge for many higher educational platforms and platforms, let's call them that, being here, the University of Copenhagen, being CBS and so on, is that still the way they are run are rather anachronistic. In terms of that you can take a subject on entrepreneurship, on let's say sharing economy, on crowdsourcing, on leadership in new alternative ways where you involve your employees and so on. But I think many of the platform, I don't know if this is the same as here in Aarhus, but from my experience, there's a lot of silos. Meaning that if you want to make an event or if you want to make a collaboration with many of the both universities and business schools, then you have to talk to this department and they cannot give you an answer before they talk to this department. They have to talk to this department and the different budgets. It's very silo built and based. And for me, when it comes to creativity, we have to balance on the edge between different areas of competence and knowledge. So if it comes to creativity, we have to tear down these silos. So when it comes to that, I think that the universities and business schools can be better at tearing down silos so they don't only teach it, but also practice it.
Yeah, right. So the educational institutions need to implement creative leadership themselves.
Nobody dares
to
clap. Big brothers
watching. That's a
very
good, you can teach them, Christian. You can, but I'm gonna jump to the question with 19 votes, because, no, the number two, there was 21. Yes. So the traditional leadership, you kind of mentioned that yourself with the educational institutions anyway. Mm-hmm. How will they fail? Will they fail in the future, or
depending on how you define traditional leadership, you say skills.
That, I think that's with the facts and figures and the boxes and the key performance indicators and the.
Nothing in life is black and white, you know, and this also goes when it comes to leadership. It's so easy, and a lot of people say this today, you know, forget about KPIs, don't measure anything and so on, and I don't believe in that. I don't believe in that. I have to say that right away. But I think we're going to see a paradigm shift in terms of how we should and have to be leaders in the future. Because we're going to see to an increasing degree more and more of our so-called, in parentheses even, employees. They are freelancers. Because of new electronic digital platforms and possibilities, we'll have more and more of our employees not being together with us physically. We outsource production, meaning, you know, we have to have somebody sitting in, you know, in the Far East and so on. We think more and more globally in terms of how we do our sales, meaning we have to have somebody sitting from the very early in the morning speaking to Asia, somebody staying late at night speaking to the US. And so on and so forth, meaning that the old school hands-on leadership is not going to be so easy in the future. Plus, going in and going out of employees is going to increase. More and more freelancers. Some people talk about that before 2030, more than half of all employees are going to be freelance. Somebody says told me that based on different inquiries and so on. Is that too big a number? Maybe, but it's just to say it is a big tendency, especially with your generation, Generation Y and so on, you know, be more flexible, kind of being illoyal, just to say it as this, having what I normally call a more horizontal way of looking at career. In the old times, in our generation, Gen X, I guess, or maybe you're Gen Y also.
40?
Gen X. Born between 65 and 79, you know, we had, and especially the baby boomers before us, they had this more vertical way of looking at career. In Kai Holger's tid, you started in a basement lifting boxes, and then if you're really good, you grew up through the ranks and you became manager in the same company. But I'm sure most of you think much more horizontally. That's also what I meet in the different upstart companies that I work with people your age group, meaning that you don't want to just have three different jobs in your life. You want to have three different careers. Maybe you want to work for an NGO in Africa. You want to be a CEO, but you also want to live out your dream as being a designer or an artist. So a whole other way of looking at a career, meaning you're going to change jobs much more than former generations. So this means that we have to work with our employees in another way. And one of the most important ways is that communication becomes key, even more than it already is. Involvement becomes key. The acknowledgement of that we as leaders set the emotional tone in the company becomes key. And then, as the most important thing, we as leaders, meaning if we don't have this skill, we should be a manager instead, and there's a difference. Hmm. We as leaders, we have to be able to create meaningful companies. There was a big inquiry based on an inquiry and a thesis from Harvard Business School made public half a year ago about meaningful companies that show that meaningful companies are simply doing better, earning more money. And why? Because meaningfulness creates motivation. Motivation creates production. Production creates bottom line. So we have to be able, that's why when I work in Afghanistan, this is what I call company karma. This is about creating meaningfulness. And why do we have to do that? Because the traditional meaning-giving streams in the world is disappearing. Religion is losing power. Tradition is losing power. Ritual is losing power. National state is losing power. So people are looking for, especially you guys, you're looking for meaning, I think, meaning and identity, new and alternative places. And where do you use 7, 8, 10 hours a day in your companies? So meaningfulness and the ability to create that as a leader, that's going to be important also.
I have a follow-up on that, and then we'll go to a questions from the audience, but I need to follow up on that, because going back to the football tournament in Afghanistan, you also mentioned afterwards, looked at all the press we got, and this is where we can differentiate ourselves from Adidas and Nike. I don't know who they are, but you mentioned them. And so still, even though you were out being good and behaving very well, and that was a big issue for you, that it was a good idea in PR-wise anyhow. Yes. So which comes first? Meaningful behavior or payoff?
Also a super good question. I think these two things are intertwined. If they can be combined, that's optimal. In the book I wrote together with Professor Sten Hillebrand from this place, great guy called Company Karma, we explain it in the following way, that when you do projects optimally, we should create a quadruple win, namely that we create value for the company itself, yes, but also for employees, for partners and customers, and then of course also for the projects, the courses that we believe in. So the quadruple win notion is important, but I think it should be combined.
Right.
Yeah, that's a short.
Yeah,
short answer.
Let's. We have the first one. Can you please rise up and just say your name?
Hi, I'm Mia. You're talking a lot about this creativity in karma, and I see how that is closely related to Hummel and the sports and you know, good karma like the one in Afghanistan. But how do you secure that in all aspects of Thornico, like in the real estate and in shipping and stuff like that? How do you make sure that you bring this creativity and karma with you all the way?
Very good question. And to those who are judging, that is Sarah and Tulle. Where's Sarah? Sarah and Tulle? Yeah, okay, you're Sarah, you're writing? Okay, good. Very good question. because there's an answer. We've worked with this for quite some years, and for sure there's been too big a gap between what I said and what we did. I think so. It's not true totally, but it's true in terms of all the how to work with it internally. How that the production guy in Brazil, that he also knows about it. He didn't, you know, just some years ago, he Company Karma, what is that? We did all the things we said we did, you know, on the front end and so on. But in terms of the internal, rooting of the value and of the thinking, there's been a big gap. But what we've done, numerous things, and that's why I like the question. First of all, I said some years ago that it was not good enough. So what we did was we said to Syddansk Universitet, Aarhus, we said to them, guys, and they have four PhDs that works with CSR and so on. Now you get carte blanche to the whole Thornico group. Meaning that today and for the last 2 years, I've had PhDs from Syddansk Universitet that were allowed to go wherever they wanted, whenever they wanted. Board meetings, directors meetings, whatever. To listen, on the pipes, and then come to with suggestions and so on, of course, but as a way of really opening the company up totally. On the basis of that, and also bilaterally with other processes and so on, we have done a lot of things. Now all companies, the whole group, they have also to secure the back-end part, they have CSR, KPIs, talking about KPIs. That can be CO2 footprint, it can be waste, it can be energy, it can be reducing the number of working-related accidents and so on, that we simply measure on. And then on the front end, I have three different pillars. There's CSR, back end, there's front end, like Afghanistan and so on, and then there's the cultural part, creating meaning internally and so on. On that part, we do all kinds of things. Every year, we crown the best karma employee. We have a new thing, a new platform, you should check it out on thornico.com if you want to, called My Karma, where all the employees, they can upload their own projects, and then we give from Thornico 25,000 kroner tax-free to the project, and so on. So it's not only a Thornico thing, but also to pay it forward. So you think about it also in your spare time. And on the front end, for instance, in real estate, some years ago, we did Europe's biggest green parking house. Turning around of CO2 to oxygen equivalents 250 trees meaning that at your parking house that has ivy around it, that's the biggest park in Rotterdam, as an example. 2 years ago, I did the biggest urban farm in Europe, where we have our own bees on the top of the farm. Of course, Hummel also have their own bee, you know, the Hummel logo. And now we're doing our own bee beer that all the tenants are going to get, and so on. So long story short, we have both cultural CSR-based and front-end projects in all bigger companies in Thornico today. But if you asked me 4 years ago, we wouldn't have.
All righty.
Super question.
Yeah, and fantastic answer. Very long as well, Christian. Yeah. Sorry. We'll have one more from the audience.
Hello. Yes. Hello. My name is Adam.
Hello, Adam.
It seems to me that when you had this Afghanistan project, it really was a turning point for the Hummel company, and you find a mission and a vision that you could work on. If you should look back at Hummel before that turning point, what would you say were the main purpose of the company? What was and how was it supporting your personal core values? And what does it change for you as a leader when you figure out this is the mission we are going for?
Was a very interesting question, Alan. Before, we also worked with Karma, or what I call Karma-related projects before in Africa, making football schools and so on, the Tibet national team and so on. But this was, it was a bigger project, it had more impact. And that's why I had this radical change for us. So before, even though we did these projects we had a more opportunistic approach to what we did. The strategy was not as clear. And it was more about, trying to survive as a company. You know, I moved out of the board of directors when we earned 25 million kroner EBT, earnings before tax. That was a kind of my inner guideline. But that's not more than 7 years ago. So for 7-8 years, I wouldn't say we struggled. We tried to find our sea legs in terms of who should we be in the marketplace, finding really revenue drivers that we could scale and that really worked. So to answer your question, it was about surviving. It was more about surviving before. But now it's fantastic for me, you know, that thing, because this also relates to my own personal values, even though, you know, some people think that we are kind of a religious company and that, you know, we give all our surplus away to philanthropy, and I only drink green tea. Okay, I actually do, and I meditate all day and so on. But, you know, I also meditate, but not all day and so on. So, you know, so for me, there's a certain correlation between myself as an owner and how we work.
And Christian, because that kind of leads to that question that a lot of people voted for. I think you pretty much answered it, because as it's also a follow-up on that one. Which of your personal characteristics, number two with the 37 votes, which of your personal characteristics would you think is the most important for your success and for the future of your company?
First of all, and you can say, is that a personal characteristic to find the right people? But we talked also to some of your colleagues here during the essay session that team is nearly everything, you know, and many a time the jockey is more important than the horse. And I really think that's true. The team is so important, and especially in a rather volatile marketplace and in a swift shifting market. So the team is very important. So the ability to find the right team players make the right team, I think that's a really important characteristic. A little bit more, you can say.
And you're very good at that, if you should say it yourself?
Actually, not especially. I think even more, my CEOs, and then I may be good at choosing the right CEOs together with the rest of the board. They are good at making their teams, I have to say. But a special characteristic for myself, you know, it really is on my core, because there's super many things that I'm really bad at. And I really think a good thing is, you know, to look at your whole aggregated skill set and look at, you know, what are you good at? What are you like mediocre at, and what are you're bad at? And if you can, to a certain degree, eliminate what you're bad at least there will always be something that you're like, you know, so on, you know, and then concentrate about your core about your core competence. I think that's really important. That has been a big decision for me to do in naming that. And in terms of that, I think the thing about meaningfulness, I think that I'm okay at creating that. Secondly, in terms of the I'm a more go-to-market guy. I'm a front-end guy. You know, I can do administration. It's my core competence. Hell not. So I'm more front-end guy, you know, market positioning, sales, marketing, branding, you know, and so on. So yeah.
So meaningfulness and then your ability to analyze yourself, sounds like that you can see the good and the bad sides in yourself.
Yeah, maybe.
So I think you kind of also answered that from mid with 42 votes, but and it kind of go back to the cave of the lion again. But do you invest in people or in ideas?
Also, super good question. I think it's difficult to differentiate because, you know, the idea alone is nothing. You know, normally when I talk about, and also as Lena and I talk about in the book here, in terms of a definition on what creativity is, and I have to say that when we talk about creativity, it's a hard economical creativity. It's not about, you know, touching the color purple and so on. There we say, as a definition of creativity, creativity is something new, but something that's new that cannot stand alone. It's something new that also creates value, meaning the idea that is still in the drawer is not creative. That's not a good idea. So you have to have the idea, but also the people to roll out the idea, to implement the idea and so on, for it to create real value, either economical value or social value or what it is that you measure on.
So let's talk a bit about Thornico, because the big mother company of the many different companies that's under it. You said 120, was that what you said? Did I write it down correctly? That's a lot. Yeah. We have basically two questions, like the one you have interest in large number of companies. Can you still contribute or make a difference in all of them? And I think we can combine it with an earlier speaker here today, Lars Rabian from Novo, who said that their focus was all about focus on core competences. And how do you see that happening in Thornico?
Also really interesting perspectives, I have to say. can you still contribute and make a difference in all of them? I think yes, but that is also only because of the before mentioned, namely they have strong teams. So from a board perspective, we lead through our leaders. Some companies, I'm still very operational.
Which one would that be, for instance?
I'm still rather operational in Hummel. I have maybe, I don't know, 15, 20 mails related to Hummel a day. And that is not normal as an owner and as a chairman. So I'm still rather operational there. So I think I can make a difference. But mainly when I lead through my CEOs and CFOs and board of directors, I think so. But some places more than others. And you say... Yeah, some place more than others. I think that's kind of a short answer.
Are you the kind of person that can see yourself whether you can contribute or not, or do you take a hinge from the CEO if you should just back off?
No. I don't know what I'm saying no to, but
no. Can you see it yourself? Do you know when to back off? Do you know when to not interfere? Because this is really not a business that you know so much
about.
Yeah,
I think we've found a pretty good balance through the years, you know, and I think there's a kind of certain unspoken, you know, say, knowledge in terms of the respective competences around the table and so on, and we're very close to all the companies, you know, and that's also one that maybe you read that in the press, that, you know, we have tried to take external board members in, but it hasn't worked for us. I cannot think of any other company. I think we're the biggest company in Denmark without any external board members. Is that a good thing? Maybe not. But for us, the challenge has been that we are so close to the companies. So when we get to the time that there's a board meeting, then we already know everything. So the whole board meeting is about repeating towards the external guy or girl. So is it going to change in the future? It might, but that's a longer strategic story.
And then, I mean, you mentioned in your presentation that being a conglomerate was a big part of surviving and being a success during the financial crisis and the aftermath as well. Is that the path you're going to continuing on, or is there going to be more core focus in Thornico?
Also, super question. I have to be careful what I promise here. Depending on what, I think we get a lot of nice promises today. What pillar? We try to focus and try to go more deep within the existing seven main pillars.
Is 120 companies too much?
Again, 120, that's with daughter companies and so on. So it sounds very, you know, big and so on, but of course it's with daughter companies. So
how many is it if you just count like the mother?
If you really go to the mother, then it's maybe... 30, 40 companies.
Okay, and 30 or 40 companies too much for Thornico?
I don't think, you know, it's going pretty well. And,
you don't want to answer. That's okay. This is supposed to be a nice...
I just had my quarterlies. I just received my quarterlies from my CFO yesterday. And we actually, if I can brag a little bit, coming out with the best, I think, result ever on EBT for 2015. It's still not good enough in terms of return on sales. But so it's going quite well, you know. So
All right, we'll go back to the track on creativity and innovation. And how can that help, for instance, protect human rights of all citizens and also democracy in the Middle East? Like, how can these values make a better world? I think that the question is.
Yeah, but I think it's a good question also because it relates a little bit to what I said in the beginning with that example, with that needle point, that a strong idea is also an idea that can make positive change. That's also what Mary Murdoch talks about in creative leadership, because when she talks about it, it's very much about that the strong ideas that the creative leadership can create positive change when we talk about a sustainable future and so on. So I think there's a really close correlation there. And I think all of us, we live in a fantastic age, an age where so much wealth is aggregated. You know, we've seen that before, you know, in the beginning of industrialization and so on, your Rockefellers and so on. But I think this, what makes this day and age more interesting is that we have all these guys, your Mark Zuckerbergs, your Larry Pages and Sergey Brins, your Elon Musks and so on. But they have aggregated a lot of value. But at the same time, they work with innovation in a whole different way that all the former billionaires, they were probably also at that time, or they were also at that time, did. I had the privilege of meeting Larry Page at one time when I was keynoting for Google. And, you know, I think he's an artist. That's another thing. He's a really strange guy, I have to tell you. But the CEO now again for Google, but also super interesting guy. And they have, if you don't know it, check it out. They have Google X, where they look into all kinds of new inventions. They have the self-driving car, they have Google Glass and so on, but also they have other, daughter companies and divisions. They look into eternal life, for instance. Imagine people, because they have a market value at about $500 billion US dollar, that they use some of that money, okay, valuation is not the same as money in the pocket, but still, they use some of that money to look at how can we create eternal life. Yeah. And the funny thing is that Larry Page, he told in an interview that he has found out that if you eradicate cancer, you only reduce the average lifespan with 3 years. So that doesn't work. It had to be for something else. So just say Elon Musk, his projects with Mars through SpaceX, now with the whole his battery concept related to Tesla. Fantastic. So we have these guys that has money, but they also use them for these kinds of things to create also a positive change looking forward. Bill and Melinda Gates, maybe the best example.
So you think there's hope? That's what I hear you say. It's not as bad as one sometimes think.
And very related to creativity.
What is it like? 1% of the world owns 99% or something. We have a question down in, coming in there. Yeah, thank you. Oh, it's not on. Wait, microphone's not on. We have a hand mic in the room. Yeah, we try now. Go.
You look like one of the guys from the Kung Fu movies from the 70s. Like.
Oh.
Sorry.
Yes. Well, then I'll try again. Hello, Christian.
Hi.
I study business intelligence, master in business intelligence. And in our field of study, we say that tomorrow's companies, data is religion. So it feels like you are a leader with a gut feeling. Mm-hmm. So what is your take on a data-driven business?
Also, a super good question, Sarah and Tulin. Whether data, is going to be the new religion. I think data is super important, and it actually relates very closely to the question just before, because one of the reasons how Larry Page found out that eradicating cancer was not the way, that was through big data. You know, in terms of of course, I have a rather good platform in terms of looking at what people are, searching on and so on through Google amongst other platforms and so on. So I think for me, data is super important. You know, I even go as far as sometimes, I say that mooling is more important than meaning. I measure much more than most people probably think. I remember, again, my old, still very good friend and co-author of company Karma, Steen, he said, you get what you measure. And that's one of my favorite mottos. You get what you measure. What you focus on, what you measure on, what you have top of mind will grow to a further degree than what you're not focused on. So I like measuring, and I think the whole data thing in terms of big data, and so I think that's super interesting. And again, I'm involved with more than 20 tech companies, and of course, all of these companies are data driven. But I don't think data can stand alone. Okay, let's look even further in the future. Stephen Hawking, robots taking over the world, artificial intelligence being the biggest threat towards humanity. You're probably studying these things also. It's super interesting. I don't know if he's right. But for me, when I talk about leading with the gut, with intuition, there's not just something like this, again, feeling the color purple and touching the cosmos and, sitting around in a circle and touching each other different places. Feeling very rowdy. Intuition is based on aggregated knowledge. It's like Malcolm Gladwell, what he writes about in Blink, for instance. You have to aggregate knowledge for a good idea to pop up from your subconscious level, or what you call the undermined. Also big data. So for me, it's about working super hard, looking at the data, looking at the budgets, looking at the markets, the sales figures, the conversion rates, all of these numbers, and then maybe having these data points, aggregate and mix subconsciously from there, and from that puddle, they can maybe sometimes come a good idea and so on. So for me, intuition is not just a kind of a hippie thing.
Right.
So yeah, but a super good question.
Another good question. So we're getting closer to the end now. We're going to go a bit over time, but that's because we need all the other auditoriums to get in here for the prize ceremony, which starts 10 over. So we have 10
when
more minutes.
When you talk about the prize ceremony, is that for the jersey?
Yeah, we also have that prize ceremony.
Yeah.
And before getting to that prize ceremony, we just need just one last question, focusing on yourself, Christian, a build of self-reflection, maybe.
Enough about me, let's talk about me.
Yeah, let's talk about you, exactly. So going back, maybe we need some career advice here for the audience as well. If you go 20 years back, that would make you 24?
23.
What advice would you give yourself?
The thing about age, I found out that I'm now 1 year older than Elvis was when he died.
Oh no.
Fat and old with sideburns and a burger. I'm 1 year older than him. Very bad. I remember Dennis Leary, the comedian, Dennis Leary.
But what would you give, advice would you give yourself?
I come back to Dennis Leary, he wrote in one of his books, he wrote, I'm so happy that Jesus died when he was 33, because if he had lived as long as Elvis, he'd be walking around Jerusalem with a big fat gut and had sideburns. Okay, never mind. But what advice?
What would you tell yourself now, 20 years older and more experienced? And
first of all, don't be so harsh on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been very tough on myself. I think in terms of, maybe not, thinking that I maybe do a good enough job and so on. I think not be so harsh on yourself, especially when you're young, 20s, no age. Warren Buffett is 85, it's no age. There's a lot of time, especially, you're probably going to live, all of you, or 50% of you, until you're 100. So don't be so hard on yourself. Try some things. When it comes to creativity and innovation, we have to produce. Quantity equals quality. So we have to try some things. Like when we're skiing, if we don't fall on the piste, we don't try hard enough. So try some things. One study and try another thing. Start up a company, you're going to fail. Try something else. Try some things. Don't be so hard on yourself. That's one thing. And another thing is follow your passion. Follow your passion. I found my passion through doing the business that I did. But I would have liked to have gotten that advice before, because again, talking also Malcolm Gladwell and his book Outliers, with the 10,000 hours we have to use before we become good at something. Mm-hmm. We have to work hard, but we're never going to work hard if we don't have fun in terms of what we're doing. And that's like Bill Gates. You know, why did he become so good at what he did? It was because he simply worked hard. You know, all the stories, you know, about him goes that he left work much later than all of the guys. When they came in the next morning, he was there again. You know, you have to work hard. But for you to want to work hard, you have to be passionate. So if you right now know, of course, a little bit different when you're starting, you have to also look a little bit and explore. But if you right now know you're not on the right shelf, change yourself quicker or quick.
So give yourself a break and just try it out. Yes. Yeah. Alrighty, so prize ceremony time for the questions. Yes. So how should we do this? Oh, we had somebody count.
The boss, Tulle. Shall I read them or do you want to read them?
Oh, we have a vote. I just need to look over the no. Well, we'll take that afterwards. That's okay. So we'll have the question ceremony.
So shall I just repeat these names? Okay. Well, the question is, which is the biggest presents, the books or the jerseys?
You decide, Christian.
Okay. Okay, let's jump into it. The winner of this book in the shower with Picasso about creativity and innovation is the famous, on campus, famous Peter H.
Peter H. Woo! There he is.
Shall he come up here?
I think he comes up here, yeah. Okay, but that's okay. You can just mention the number two, because otherwise we're running
out
of time.
It's very cool that Peter H. very, very short.
Yeah, I can. Yeah.
Okay, that's the book.
That's the book. You can just get
and
number two. Yep. Come up here, Peter H.
Hi, Peter. Yeah. Let's go.
Tak for det.
Tak for godt spørgsmål, og tak for din interesse. Yeah. And the second book goes to another famous character here on campus, famous for his guitar playing during the fredagsbar, I don't know, called Søren Gadebjerg.
Søren Gadebjerg, right. Thanks, Dan, yeah? Okay. All right. Let's get one more up here, Christian. Christian, should we get one more up while Søren is coming?
And for the, I think he's a guy that likes the whole payoff of this shirt, the credo, you never smoke alone. The guy that likes Christiania and likes the credo, that is Mikkel Andersen.
Mikkel Andersen.
Arvidsen.
Yeah.
Arvidsen.
Are you here? Yeah. Fantastic.
Tillykke med det.
Tak.
Og du vandt bogen også.
Ja. Tak.
Tak for godt spørgsmål, tak.
Great. All right.
Is that Mikkel?
Yeah.
I was right.
So
I was right.
And how many prizes do we have left?
Two more left.
Yeah.
And the fourth prize, which is a jersey, and I think it should probably be the Afghanistan jersey. I think that's a medium, if I'm not mistaken. That goes to a girl who's famous because she thinks she's so cool, like Madonna, and Medina. She only has one word on one name. It's Mia.
Mia, right?
Oh yeah. We already met her. So, jeg tror, at du kan passe den her, Mia.
Ja, det spørger godt.
Perfekt. Tillykke. Tak for også spørgsmålet. Tak. And the last present goes to, I remember his name from up there, and he has the same name as my father, has a good name, the Nordic god, the guy with the hammer, and I know that this guy also wears briefs that are called hammer, Thor. And it's namely Thor Hønberg Bur.
Thor! Where are you? He disappeared.
Where's Thor?
Right, Thor? Thor, are you here? Maybe going to the bathroom or something. I don't know. All right, well, Thor?
Hyggenhauge.
Hyggenhauge.
He's live streaming.
Live streaming. Ah.
He's in New York.
How cool can you be? Okay. Cool. Well, fine.
Yes.
We'll ship it.
You're going to give this to Thor Hyggenhauge.
Yeah, we'll ship it.
Yes.
Thank you. Fantastic.
Yes.
So. So we have apparently an active poll going on. That's the audience that's supposed to answer it. Yeah. And so you go to your devices now and you are going to answer the question, what do you think a leader in charge of a large... it's for Christian. Sorry, I get it now. What do you think a leader in charge of a large organization can do to promote innovation? Please elaborate in keywords and short sentences.
It's not for me, is it?
Is that for... It's not for... Yeah, Christian wanted.
So I'm finished? Okay. Thank you. Perfect.
No.
Okay.
No.
Thank you.
No.
Okay. Oh, sorry.
All right, then no, because we have two little more questions. We have two more important questions that we need to answer before we go to this.
Please.
We have the one Christian. Christian, we have two little questions. I have two little questions. One, are there any availabilities in the apartments in Guldsmedgade?
Not right now.
No? All right, yeah. I was wondering more than you would, yes. would like to know that. And number two.
But in 3 months.
All right, sign up. Anyway.
250 square meter, very nice.
That's very good, yeah.
Iben Jejle, she always stays there when she's doing a digte.
Is shared apartments allowed? Do you allow a group?
Yeah, preferably like a couple, but of course they're rather expensive, 250,
exactly.
So if it's nice persons, then we can, you know.
Then you can talk about it.
Yeah, if you're looking for like apartments, contact Tula and Sarah, and they can give you my...
No, that's fantastic.
Yes.
That's a very good offer. And now, Christian,
yes.
Final question. You know what it is? Do I need to repeat it?
Oi, I didn't.
Oh, yeah, but I didn't. So what about it? Are we going to see you in season two? Can we break the news? Or should we give you the time?
Can you record this? Because then we should send it to the producer. Are you recording this?
Yeah, we are.
Can I get the clip?
Yeah.
Because then I'm going to send this clip to the producer, Mads from United. Okay? That's the guy that's producing it in Løvenshul. I'm saying yes.
Woo! Yeah.
Thank you.
That's it for me then. I'll shut up.
Thank you.
Right. So it looks like most of the participants are here now. So I would just like to thank you, Christian Stadil, for an interesting talk.
Thank you.
And for your contribution to Aarhus Symposium.
Thank you.
Please accept this gift from us that you can enjoy some time.
Thank you much. Very kind of you. Thank you.
Here's a gift for you as well, Nina Munk-Pine.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for taking part in Aarhus Symposium once again. As you can see, we have a question that we would like you to answer. Please do it afterwards. It will help us. In a few moments, the Aarhus Symposium Award will be announced here on this stage. In the meantime, please welcome our steering committee of this year's Aarhus Symposium.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Anne, and this is Rune and Alexander, and together we are the steering committee of Aarhus Symposium 2015. The week of Aarhus Symposium has almost come to an end. It has been a great week, starting on Monday with Battle of the Economists, and today has been a great and interesting day with enlightening talks and an intriguing climate debate. Thank you to all the speakers and the participating students for engaging in dialogues throughout the day. It has been truly very inspiring. We would also like to thank our partners and foundations for your support and commitment. It is highly appreciated. And finally, we would like to thank Aarhus University and Aarhus Business for your supportive attitude towards us year after year. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them all a round of applause.
Now, before we move on to the Aarhus Symposium Award, we also want to thank a very special group. This day would not have been possible without the dedication and passion from the volunteer students behind Aarhus Symposium. Please, help us thank and welcome on stage the organizing committee of Aarhus Symposium 2015. We have learned a lot working together with such smart and passionate people. Your hard work throughout the year has been incredible. With high ambitions follows high expectations and long days at the office. It has been a great pleasure. We are also proud to introduce to you the steering committee of Aarhus Symposium 2016, Line and Camilla.
Lena and I are very honored and excited to be the steering committee of 2016. This year's steering committee has shown us how to create and lead an innovative, committed, and motivated organizing team, making this year's Aarhus Symposium an extraordinary event. We are eager to take on this challenge for next year. To do this, we need dedicated and ambitious students to join us. All the details on how to apply will be posted on our website and Facebook page this Sunday. We look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
And now, it is time to reveal the winner and the runner-up of the Aarhus Symposium Award 2015. We are very proud that so many of you here today have engaged in the challenges proposed. Almost 400 students participated in the challenge, contributing with unique insights and perspectives on the challenges of today and tomorrow. On behalf of the Executive Board of Aarhus Symposium, our Chair, Nina Schmidt, will announce the winners. Please welcome on stage, Nina Schmidt.
Yes, thank you. As was just said, it's been really, really tough work for us to select the two winners, a number two and a number one for this Aarhus Symposium Award. The winner, the number two, the winner of the runner-up, or the runner-up, you might say, award. For this, we have selected Katrine Cecilie Petersen. Please join us on stage.
The runner-up receives a wireless speaker from Rifa. Please give another round of applause to the runner-up.
I should give a few words about your essay. The title was Creating the Right Incentives, and it sketches the needs of a global price system based on sustainable prices on energy and carbon emissions. Yeah, I would say as an economist, this is really classical externality pricing. I guess you are an economist?
Yeah.
Yes. Fine. I would say this is a really thoughtful essay on initiatives securing our future. It's in that category. Yes, thank you so much, and give a hand. Yes, and then we have the winner. The winner is Oscar Harmsen.
The winner receives the main prize of 10,000 Danish kroner, as well as a Mont Blanc pen from Aarhus Symposium. Please give the winner of the Aarhus Symposium Award 2015 another round of support. Applause.
Yes. I should say there were no disagreement in the committee concerning the your name, because this was really, I think, a very, very interesting essay. I'll start to read up the introduction of the essay. Law, yeah, I should say, this is in the category of ensuring the success of a startup. And you start out with law number one. No matter how hard you try, how bright you are, how brilliant your product is, and so on, you cannot be sure of success. Okay, you think this is not really going in the right direction. Then you discuss timing is important, chance may spoil everything, negative shocks may spoil everything. And you say, you discuss, you have to strive for excellence, you have to build a brilliant product, work hard, and so on. And then you end up saying, law number two, remember that. Law number two, if you believe in the first law, you will never have a chance. Take that.
And now it is time to have a drink and a bite to eat. We kindly ask participants at track one and two to go to the M building, and participants at track three and four to the upper S area. Ladies and gentlemen, today we are taking time to connect, to reflect, and to engage in the challenges and opportunities within leadership and technology. Thank you all. We wish you a wonderful night, and see you next year.